Mario Lemieux is unlike any other player in NHL history. He was a generational talent, his career arc was straight out of Hollywood, and he had an aura about him that suggested no challenge, on or off the ice, was too daunting. So how did an introvert from a humble neighborhood in Montreal become Super Mario, not only on skates, but also in a suit and tie? This is the story behind Mario Lemieux. Mario Lemieux was born to Pierrette and Jean-Guy on October 5th, 1965. Pierrette was a stay-at-home mom, Jean-Guy worked in construction, and the Francophone family of five lived in Villemard, a working-class neighborhood in southwest Montreal. Villemard had previously churned out Maurice Vachon, the legendary professional wrestler who went by the stage name Mad Dog Vachon, as well as the pro hockey player Richard Campo, an NHL draft pick who starred in the World Hockey Association. Lemieux would blossom into Villemard's most notable resident, in part due to countless hours spent on the area's outdoor rinks, including one behind a church close to home. He began skating at 3 years old, alongside brothers Alain and Richard. The Lemieux boys would play with neighborhood buddies for hours after school, shuffling home only when it got too dark. Sometimes, the boys would then skate indoors. As legend has it, Dad would pack snow over the hallway carpet and leave the door open. It didn't take long for Jean-Guy to realize his youngest son was special, somebody destined for the pros. The proud papa once told the New York Times that a six-year-old Lemieux was a leader on the ice, a star competing with and against kids 3 or 4 years his senior. In performance and size, Jean-Guy said, Lemieux was always bigger. During his minor hockey days, Lemieux shared the ice with Marc Bergevin and JJ Daniel, two future NHLers who now hold high-profile positions in management and coaching. Lemieux dreamed of being Guy Lafleur, the charismatic center for the 1970s Montreal Canadiens, which was a dynastic group that captivated the entire province of Quebec.
Robinson à Lafleur.
Lemieux officially entered the public consciousness himself in the early 1980s, when he was selected first overall in the 81 QMJHL draft. He would go on to rack up a whopping 562 points in 200 games for the Laval-Voisin. Lemieux even broke Lafleur's single-season goal record in his third and final junior season. He scored 133 times in 70 games and added 149 assists for 282 points, or a cartoonish 4 points per game. Despite the extreme dominance, Lemieux wasn't universally praised ahead of the 1984 NHL draft. Some scouts believed the 6'4", 200-pound right-handed center was lazy and lacked the heart required to truly stand out in the best league on the planet. Lemieux and his agents disagreed. They felt disrespected. And contract discussions with the Pittsburgh Penguins, the woeful franchise that owned the top pick, were contentious in the lead-up to the draft. While the Penguins ultimately chose Lemieux at number one, the sharply dressed 18-year-old remained in his seat after the selection, refusing to meet with his new bosses at the Pens draft table. He said the team didn't really want me enough.
Normally, the routine is for the youngster to go down to the table and shake hands with his new employer. But because of what Gus Padale said, Mario Lemieux is sitting right there.
Gus Padale had told us that you would not walk to the Pittsburgh table. Your reaction, your feeling?
Well, you know, I don't feel to go downstairs on the floor, and because I think Pittsburgh don't really want me enough to go downstairs, so that's why I'm staying here, my family, all my friends.
The drama was short-lived, as Lemieux put pen to paper on his first big league contract a couple of weeks after the draft. The deal signaled the dawn of a new era in Pittsburgh. The Pens had won only 16 of 80 games the season prior, tanking decades before the polarizing talent acquisition strategy became a buzzword in sports. Just 7,000 fans were showing up to home games, so the club was in desperate need of a marketable face. The rangy and opportunistic Lemieux contributed immediately.
Fourth, the crowd excited, and there is Mario Lemieux, and he is off, racing in all alone. Lemieux, his first shot on goal, and he scores! Mario Lemieux, living up quickly.
By the end of the regular season, Lemieux had 43 goals and 100 points in 73 games for the second worst team in the league. He won Rookie of the Year honors in a landslide. From those early games, all the way through the prime of his career, nobody made dominating an NHL game look so easy. Lemieux possessed an exceptional blend of size and strength, grace and finesse, intelligence and sense. He was a towering presence, yet economical in his movements. It was as if he had been created in a hockey laboratory.
6-6 to score here in the third, lead pass to Lemieux. Lemieux now coming down the left wing, cuts for the net. Lemieux's in, his backhand shot, score! Oh, stop the press!
The Pens continued to spin its wheels as a team, missing the postseason in five of Lemieux's first six seasons in the league. On an individual level though, Lemieux quickly earned the nickname Le Magnifique. As a team, he had chosen the jersey number 66 because it was an upside down 99. And here he was, barely into his 20s and becoming a rare peer to the great one, Wayne Gretzky. In the 80s, Gretzky rewrote the point-getting record books while winning four Stanley Cups with the Edmonton Oilers. At the peak of their powers, Lemieux and Gretzky both seemed immortal, worthy of a promotion to a league above the NHL, if only such a league existed. That said, they went about their business differently. Lemieux, the soft-spoken private megastar, was a shoot-first goal scorer with uncanny puck control and deception. Gretzky, the outgoing, public-facing megastar, was a pass-first playmaker with unparalleled vision and timing. It was a gift from the hockey gods that arguably the two greatest forwards of all time overlapped for 15 years. They took turns claiming Hart and Art Ross trophies in a high-scoring physical era, and also dazzled as line mates at the 87 Canada Cup. The legendary Gordie Howe summed up the dynamic to Sports Illustrated. Gretzky did a better job of using his teammates. Lemieux was more of an individual talent.
Howard Chuck wins it in. Here's Lemieux poking at the center. Lemieux ahead to Gretzky. Has Murphy with him on a 2-on-1 to Lemieux. And on goal, he shoots, he scores! Mario Lemieux with 1:26 remaining.
In one game against the New Jersey Devils in late 88, Lemieux scored 5 goals in 5 unique ways. Then 23, Lemieux bagged 1 goal at even strength, 1 on the power play, 1 while shorthanded, 1 off a penalty shot, and 1 into an empty net. It was something that had never been done before, and it hasn't been replicated in 3+ decades. Gretzky is the only player in NHL history to collect 200 points in a season, and he did it 4 times. Lemieux was excruciatingly close in 88-89, when he set a career high with 199 points.
Now, there was a course of 10 games this season when Mario Lemieux actually had 45 points. Is that incredible?
That's scary.
Only 16 times has a player accumulated 150 points or more. 9 of those seasons are Gretzky's, 4 are Lemieux's, and 3 others have one to their resume. Lemieux reached such rarefied air, even though he never once, in 17 years, played a full season. Unfortunately, injury and illness followed him around just like the puck. In 89-90, Lemieux came out of the gate with a staggering 46-game point streak. He fell 5 games short of Gretzky's record of 51 thanks to a nagging back injury he could no longer ignore. He underwent surgery to repair a herniated disc, ending his season. Around this time, the Pens started ascending. By 90-91, management had surrounded Lemieux with a cast of future Hall of Famers. Jaromir Jagr, Ron Francis, Mark Recchi, Brian Trotje, Paul Coffey, and Larry Murphy. The franchise that for years couldn't get its act together finally broke through, winning its division and eventually the Stanley Cup. Lemieux, who dressed for only 26 regular season games due to the surgery, was fantastic all playoffs, producing 16 goals and 28 assists for 44 points in 23 games.
Pittsburgh, 1991, Stanley Cup champs!
To this day, his mesmerizing inside-out goal against the Minnesota North Stars in Game 2 of the Cup Final is one of the most recognizable playoff moments captured on film.
Here's Lemieux, his center penalty coming up. Look at Lemieux! Oh my heavens! What a goal! What a move! Lemieux! Oh baby!
If you go at Mario like a madman, he'll make you look like a complete idiot, Ray Bourque, a five-time Norris Trophy winner, once told Sports Illustrated. He just holds the puck there on his forehand and dares you to commit yourself. If you do, he slips it past you. And if you don't, he controls the blue line and has time to make the play. Bourque would know. Pittsburgh ran it back for 91-92, with bench boss Scotty Bowman and forward Rick Tocchet serving as the only important additions. There was a familiar result, another cup, just in smoother fashion. The Pens swept the final two rounds. And although Lemieux missed five games to nurse a broken hand courtesy of a slash by Adam Graves of the New York Rangers, he scooped up playoff MVP honors for a second time. Fresh off back-to-back cups, Lemieux ran roughshod over the NHL, tallying 104 points in 40 games to start the 92-93 campaign. The Pens were in first place, and he was on pace to challenge Gretzky's single-season points record when disaster struck. The Pens announced in January that Lemieux had been diagnosed with cancer, specifically Hodgkin's lymphoma, after an enlarged lymph node was removed from his neck.
Yeah, it is scary every time you hear the word cancer. You know, I went back home after I saw Dr. Bourque and Dr. Jones and gave me the news. And, you know, on the way down to my house, could hardly drive because of the tears and crying all day.
Lemieux missed 2 months of action for radiation treatment before reappearing unexpectedly ahead of a March game in Philadelphia. The old Spectrum Arena was traditionally a hostile place for the Pens captain. But that night, Lemieux received a huge ovation from the rival crowd.
They've got a big thing on the screen here. They got a big TV screen here, and it said, "Welcome back," and it had Mario's picture, and now he acknowledges the fans.
He picked up where he left off, too, with a two-point night. A few months later, after finishing with 160 points in 60 games, he cleaned up at the NHL Awards banquet, taking home the Hart, Art Ross, Pearson, and Masterton trophies. It's hard to grasp the full scope of the circumstances, even three decades on. Regardless, the following statement is factual. Mario Lemieux was the best and most valuable player in the top league in the world during a season in which he also beat cancer. Lemieux's ability to jump on a moving train and instantly dominate was always second to none. Sadly, he missed the bulk of the next season and the entirety of 94-95. To undergo another back surgery and cope with fatigue caused by the cancer treatment. In hindsight, this was the beginning of the end for Super Mario and the Pens' cup-winning window. Yes, Lemieux found his vintage form for 95-96 and 96-97, leading the NHL in scoring both years, while Jágr, his overqualified sidekick, played some of the best hockey of his career. But the Pens lost in the conference final 1 year, and the opening round the next, and all of a sudden, Lemieux was out of gas. He retired at 31 years old. The Hockey Hall of Fame waived his 3-year waiting period to feature Lemieux in the 1997 induction class. He looked baby-faced, standing beside his fellow inductees. Soon, Lemieux would save the Pens for a second time since being drafted. In late 98, ownership declared bankruptcy, priming the club for possible relocation. Lemieux decided to convert years of unpaid salary to equity and, along with a group of investors, purchased the franchise. 2 years removed from on-ice stardom, Lemieux suited up as team president, CEO, and chairman. He promised to keep the Pens in Pittsburgh. Of course, Lemieux couldn't resist making another comeback once he started to feel better physically in late 2000. At an emotional press conference, Lemieux rattled off a few reasons for his return. 1. He missed the game and felt the Pens had a chance to win another cup. 2. He believed the league was starting to take better care of its star players. And 3, his son Austin, a serious hockey fan, really wanted to see his dad play in the NHL.
Jágr with it. Lemieux in the middle. Lemieux scores! Mario is back!
Lemieux lived up to his words. He was an elite player again, stringing together an incredible 76 points over 43 games to earn second place in Hart Trophy voting. At 35, he wasn't young and had nothing to prove, but it didn't matter. He shined in what's considered the first modern player-owner season in North American major pro sports. From there, Lemieux appeared in parts of the next four seasons. A fifth was completely wiped out by the 04-05 lockout. And then, in 06, he retired, this time for good, because of yet another ailment, an irregular heartbeat. He was 40, tired, and frankly, running out of room on his trophy case. It already had two cup rings, a 2002 Olympic gold medal, and 17 individual awards, including 6 Art Ross, 3 Hart, and 2 Conn Smythe trophies. Lemieux was equal parts prolific and efficient throughout his storied career. He retired with 690 goals and 1,033 assists for 1,723 points in just 915 games. He trails only Mike Bossy in career goals per game and only Gretzky in both assists per game and points per game. Before calling it quits, Lemieux mentored Sidney Crosby, a generational talent also hailing from Eastern Canada. Crosby lived with the Lemieux family as a rookie, and the two icons briefly played together on the same line. Super Mario, the owner, then balked at selling the team in 2006, helped get a new arena built in 2007, before settling into the owner's suite to watch Crosby lead the Pens to cup victories in 2009, 2016, and 2017. There's a statue outside the Pens rink, which is currently named PPG Paints Arena. It shows an imposing Lemieux splitting a pair of hopeless New York Islanders defensemen, a snapshot from a real game in 88. Surely, one day a statue depicting one of Crosby's signature moments will be erected nearby. It will serve as a permanent reminder of 66's impact on 87, and not one, but two generations of Pens players and fans. That's the magic of Mario. It's what makes his life story compelling and fit for a Hollywood writer's room. He was a generational talent on the ice, and yet, so much more. Le Magnifique. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video and want to see more content from The Score, don't forget to hit that subscribe button.